Dear subscribers, as you know, we shared many information for you, and we are studying very hard to find current news for you. However, I cannot use this channel for future. Please follow our new channel called As Daily News Report and watch our video to support us. Link in description. Also, you can reach the video we shared on Daily News Report by clicking on the top right button. We highly recommend watching, subscribing, and sharing. We will continue to share some news on this channel, but we take precautions against some situations for future. Thank you for supporting us.
Your break in the Bretton Woods system, and then continuing through the Plaza and the Louvre Court in the mid-1980s. And the point is, Currency War I lasted 15 years. Currency War II lasted 20 years. Currency War III began in 2010, partly as a response to the not just the financial panic of 2008, but the recession, the technical recession, and actually the depression that followed. But here we are in 2017. It's no surprise that 7 years later, we're still in this currency war. And I would expect that we'll still be in it 2 years from now, or maybe 5 years from now, because they don't have logical conclusions. It's like a tennis match, you know, among equally, you know, talented players. The ball just goes back and forth and back and forth. You know, I devalue, you devalue, I devalue again, you devalue again, et cetera. They don't have a logical conclusion except for systemic reform. If people actually get together, as they did at Bretton Woods in 1944, or as they did in the Plaza Accord in 1985 and the Louvre Accord in 1987, and sit down and agree on what international monetary experts actually call the rules of the game. That's not a made up phrase. That's shorthand for, you know, how is the international monetary system supposed to work among the major players? That's what people mean when they say the rules of the game. Right now, there are no rules of the game, because we're in a currency war. But if you can agree on rules of the game, that's one way for currency wars to end. The other way they end is with systemic collapse, where things just spin so out of control that people lose confidence in paper money. They lose confidence in the system. They run to hard assets, gold and silver, obvious ones, but fine art, land, natural resources. There are many other alternative assets to the main currencies, and that's another way out. And again, we saw that in the Great Depression. We also saw it in 1914 at the beginning of World War I, when the New York Stock Exchange, for example, was closed for 5 months. You know, I tell people that it's obviously a historical record, but they're shocked to hear that. And, 1933, every bank in America was closed by executive order. So we have seen these kinds of extreme responses to financial panics before. So you either have systemic reform or systemic collapse. I don't see any movement towards systemic reform right now. People talk about it. Maybe they wish it would happen, but there's a lot of denial and a lot of self-interest and a lot of self-satisfaction. So I don't really see that momentum that may change. But systemic collapse is definitely in the cards. Having said that, going to the specifics of your question, where are we in the currency wars? I also made the point in my first book that currency wars lead to trade wars, and that trade wars end up being shooting wars, kinetic wars. And right now we are seeing definite signs that we're tipping into the trade war phase, particularly with the Trump administration. Now, just to illustrate that, during the presidential campaign, in the 2016 presidential campaign, Trump over and over, you know, railed against China, called China a currency manipulator. He said, you know, when I win, I'm sworn in my day one executive order, we're going to label China currency manipulator. Now, that's not actually how you do it. I mean, you can call anyone anything you like, but the currency manipulation designation comes from the U.S. Treasury. Now, granted, that could be directed by the White House, but it comes from the U.S. Treasury. It's actually scheduled for April. There's an annual review from the Treasury. It's all laid out by statute, but there's no expectation that that's going to happen. So Trump has not followed through on that. He's used the rhetoric. He actually said Germany was a currency manipulator. Interesting, because Germany doesn't have a currency. They have the euro. So he's throwing the word around, but he hasn't actually done anything. However, Trump is dead serious about trade sanctions, trade relief, and tariffs. And the team there, you see Peter Navarro, Jim Lighthizer, Sir Robert Lighthizer, the U.S. Trade Representative, and Wilbur Ross at the Secretary of Commerce. They're the troika on trade. So watch Navarro, Wilbur Ross, and Lighthizer. They're going to be pushing back against China, not on the currency front, but on the trade front. It'll be interesting to see what happens with President Xi and President Trump meeting in Mar-a-Lago next week. So we are seeing signs that currency wars are morphing into trade wars. Having said that, the currency wars are alive and well. They're being fought by central banks through either easing or tightening, and a lot of flip-flopping in the case of the Fed. I expect that will continue. As far as the kinetic war side of it, we may see the U.S. attack North Korea. I think that's very likely at this point because North Korea shows no signs of steering away from their nuclear program, their effort to basically take their plutonium, highly enriched uranium supplies, weaponize it, ruggedize it, perfect their ICBMs, and be able to launch a nuclear strike on Los Angeles and kill several million Americans. So that's happening. They'll have that capacity within probably 4 years. Clearly, the United States will not allow that to happen. And I don't see North Korea being deterred, so the U.S. will probably have to attack North Korea, and there are other hotspots around the world. So I think this sequence of currency wars, trade wars, shooting wars is playing out very much as it did in the 1920s and 30s.
You mentioned the United States going into North Korea or doing something with North Korea. Are you talking about an invasion? Or are you talking about some type of covert operation to destroy their nuclear facilities? Because won't this, like you said, it's going to kick off a shooting war. I mean, won't Russia, China, won't they step in or say something about it?
Well, it won't be an invasion. The last thing anybody wants. I think we learned our lessons in Vietnam and the Korean War that, you know, U.S. troops fighting land wars in Asia is not a good idea. So I think the Pentagon's internalized that, but there's no need for that. I think it would be a combination of, because war has many dimensions and getting more dimensions all the time as the cyber battle space expands. So I would expect, sure, possibility of covert operations, sabotage, assassination, the kind of things that were carried out against the Iranians, but also cyber warfare, which was also carried out against the Iranians. Difficult to do, but the ability to penetrate North Korean computer systems, North Korean payment systems, et cetera. But then on the kinetic side, you can just use air power and sea-based air power. We have bunker buster bombs, but you might see tactical nuclear weapons for the first time since World War II at Nagasaki and Hiroshima. You might need tactical nuclear weapons to really destroy the program. You know, there's an old saying in geopolitics, if you're going to kill the king, don't miss. In other words, if you're going to do it, do it. There's nothing worse than an attempted assassination or attempted decapitation where you fail to do the job and end up being on the wrong side of the pushback. So again, I wouldn't rule out the use of tactical nuclear weapons in North Korea, but hopefully that wouldn't be necessary. But the third vector, and this is happening now, is financial warfare. And financial warfare is not just sanctions. It's actually a form of warfare, but you carry it out through financial means. This is what I actually talked about in all of my books, the first two chapters of Currency Wars, the first two chapters of The Death of Money, which came out in 2014, New York Times bestseller. And I touch on it again in my most recent book, The Road to Ruin. But that's already happening. Now, interestingly, we had a very tough regime of economic sanctions against North Korea early in the Bush administration. And they were actually working. We were putting the North Koreans' backs were to the wall. We were frozen assets in an entity called Banco Delta Asia, which was a North Korean front, North Korean intermediary. But we backed off from that. I'm not sure why we didn't want to push that harder. I don't know exactly what threats might have been made behind the scenes. But we got some vague promises from North Korea. But then by 2006 into 2008, those promises were broken. The Obama administration didn't do anything. As far as I can tell, they just punted on the issue, and now it's been handed off to Trump. So again, North Korea shows no signs of backing away from that. But we just recently announced that North Korea was de-swifted. Now, just to explain that term, SWIFT is the Society for Worldwide International Financial Telecommunications. It's the central nervous system of the global financial system. It's a system based in Belgium through which all financial message traffic, not all, but almost all important financial message traffic moves. Getting kicked out of SWIFT, and that's what we mean by de-swifting, it's like cutting off oxygen to a patient in intensive care. I mean, they're basically going to be financially strangled. We just did that to North Korea a few weeks ago, and that's only the second time I've seen that. The first time was Iran in 2012, although that was President Obama alleviated that to some extent in 2013 in exchange for Iran agreeing to discuss nuclear weapons, and led to this memorandum, which the Trump administration now seems prepared to tear up. So, and we're also putting sanctions back on Iran again after easing up from 2013 to 2016. We're now back in the business of putting sanctions on Iran. So this is the financial warfare space. So you have special operations, cyber warfare, financial warfare, and combining the two, cyber financial warfare, and then possibly air power, all designed to either deter or degrade the North Korean nuclear program.
Now, you mentioned the SWIFT program, and Russia came out with an announcement that they're ready to separate from the SWIFT system. And I know China is also working on a separate payment system. In your view, why are they doing this?
Well, because they know it can be used against them, and it is very effective. As I say, it's, you know, like cutting off the oxygen supply is not not overstating the metaphor, so to speak. Look, we've already put Russian sanctions on Russia, but there's a financial war going on between Russia and the United States right now. If you were in a war with the United States, you would fight it aggressively and you would make preparations for worst case scenarios. And by the way, this announcement, the one you refer to, came from Elvira Nabiullina, who's the head of the Central Bank of Russia. In my opinion, she's one of the two best central bankers in the world. I would say the other one's Mario Draghi, but head of the ECB. But Mario Draghi and Elvira Nabiullina, in my view, are the only two central bankers who actually understand central banking. It's very clear that Janet Yellen and before her Ben Bernanke don't understand central banking. They've kind of bumbled through a bunch of egghead science experiments the last 9 years. But Nabiullina gets it, and so she's it's preemptive. She's saying, well, we don't think Russia's going to get kicked out of SWIFT imminently. I don't think they'll get kicked out at all. I mean, there is a kind of a board of governors. There's a governance structure. It's not anything the United States wants. Now, the U.S. has a very, very powerful voice. And before we de-SWIFTed Iran, we kicked Iran out of the dollar payment system. When I say kicked you out, what I mean is we say to all the banks, hey, if you move money for Iran, we're going to kick you out. Well, that's to Credit Suisse or UBS or Deutsche Bank or Citibank or JP Morgan. That's existential. You would basically be out of business. So they have to comply, and they don't always comply. And there have been tons of investigations and multi-billion dollar settlements and, you know, deferred prosecution agreements over banks violating some of these, prominently HSBC, but also others. HSBC seems to be JP Morgan kind of run like criminal organizations as far as I can tell. But, So we say to the big banks, if you let Iran, in this example, or Russia or North Korea move money through the system, then we're going to kick you out of the system. And obviously they can't afford to let that happen. So that was easy for the United States because we control the dollar payment system. But you get over to SWIFT, see what Iran did is they said, okay, we can't sell oil for dollars anymore because we can't receive dollars through the payment system. We'll just sell it for euros or Swiss francs or other currencies that you might want, and they could move through SWIFT. So then we kicked Iran out of SWIFT. But to do that, we need the votes of the other members of the board, which are mainly our European allies, Germany, France, UK, and some others. At this point, you sort of need China to go along as well. So I think it's unlikely that Russia would be kicked out, but they're not waiting around to find out the hard way. They're saying, okay, you cut off our oxygen supply. We got a spare oxygen tank over here. And they built an alternative payment system, and China's doing the same thing. All this, by the way, is very detrimental to the dollar's role as the leading reserve and payments currencies. And I've said this to people in Washington. I do a bit of consulting and meetings with people in the national security space, including government officials, intelligence community, Defense Department, et cetera, Treasury. And I've said to them, I said, look, using our weight, using the dollar as a weapon is extremely powerful, but be careful what you wish for, because the more you throw your weight around, the more people aren't just going to stand for it, the more they're going to build alternative systems. And someday you're going to wake up and find that, you're pushing on a string, you're trying to punish people with dollar specific sanctions, and they don't work anymore because no one needs the dollar. We're not there yet, but we're pretty far down that road.
So do you think countries like China, Russia, are they dumping treasuries, the dollar? Are they preparing to separate themselves from the dollar?
Yes, and they're doing it in several ways. One is reducing their exposure to dollar holdings, not all at once, not dumping them en masse. But if you look at, there's something called the Tick Report, which comes out from the Treasury periodically. I think it's once a month, or it's at least quarterly, but whether it's monthly or quarterly, it's available on the Treasury website. And it shows foreign holdings of U.S. Treasury securities. And if you look at the official holdings, they are going down significantly, and they have for a while. So it is true that China and Russia in particular, but other countries as well, are reducing their holdings of U.S. Treasury securities. Japan has picked up some of the slack, and U.S. banks as well. But they're reducing now. Some of that, you don't actually have to sell anything. You just, when a treasury security matures, if you own a treasury security and it matures, the treasury just sends you the money. They give you your money back, basically. It's like paying off a loan. Well, so you don't actually have to sell anything. You just have to sit there and do nothing, and your holdings will go down as long as you don't reinvest in more treasuries. And that's what's happening. They're reinvesting in euros, they're reinvesting in other securities. So this is kind of going on quietly and slowly without a major dumping operation, which the U.S. could stop by, the president has the authority to stop that if it ever became malicious. But what they are doing is buying gold. Now, China, I'll separate the official numbers from what we actually think is going on. The official numbers are they've tripled their gold reserves in the last 11 years. So from 2006 to 2017, they have officially gone from about 600 tons to about 1,800 tons of gold. But China is non-transparent based on mining output, Hong Kong exports, Swiss exports, etc. There's good reason to believe that China's gold holdings are actually more in the order of 3,000 or 4,000 tons, perhaps even higher. I've heard some reports that they're a lot higher. Russia's more transparent, but they have tripled their gold reserves as well just in the past 8 years. So they've gone from 600 tons to about 1,800 tons. So if gold is not a monetary asset, if gold is, a barbarous relic, as the critics like to say, why have Russia and China tripled their gold reserves in the last, as I say, between 5 and 10 years approximately, and continue to buy more gold every month? Russia's buying 20, 30 tons a month, sometimes more, sometimes less, but that's kind of been the run rate. Are they stupid, or do they see something that most people don't? Well, I guarantee they're not stupid. I've been to Moscow and Beijing and Shanghai and met with officials there, and they're very, very savvy. So clearly they see something that most investors don't see, and they're getting ready for this collapse of confidence in the dollar. It doesn't mean we won't have dollars. It doesn't mean the dollar goes away. But what it does mean is that the dollar very quickly and unexpectedly almost loses its status as the benchmark global reserve currency to be replaced probably by the IMF special drawing right, but if not, some new gold-backed currency.
In your book, Road to Ruin, you mentioned the financial crisis, and part of your book says the next financial crisis will not be merely a bigger version of 1998 and 2008 crisis. It will be qualitatively different. It will encompass multiple asset classes on a global scale. How big is this going to be?
It looks like an extinction level event. I mean, bigger than anything that's ever happened before. And let me explain why I say that, because it's, I don't like to make claims without backing them up with science or history or facts or, some combination of those things. When I make that point, there's sort of two vectors. One is I look at a tempo or sequence of prior financial crises. And in particular, I focus on 1998. That was the Russia long-term capital management crisis, which actually started in Asia the year before. And then I look at 2008. That was, you know, called the Lehman Brothers crisis or whatever you like. And which also started the year before in 2007 with some mortgage defaults announced at Bear Stearns and HSBC and elsewhere. So those are the two case studies I have. And then I take that 10-year tempo from 1998 to 2008, and I just take it out 10 years. It's just a convenience to maintain the 10-year tempo and talk about 2018, except I make the point that it could be tomorrow. I mean, don't think that you can just sort of put your feet up until 2018. If it's even then, this is something that could happen tomorrow. But here's the point. 1998, and by the way, I was counsel of long-term capital management. I negotiated that bailout. I was in the room with Fed and Treasury officials. We were on the phone to Tokyo. I know exactly what was going on behind the scenes there. We were just hours away from closing every major market in the world, stock markets and bond markets, at least temporarily to deal with the panic that would have ensued, because it wasn't really about long-term capital management. I mean, it's a hedge fund, right? If we had filed for bankruptcy in the Cayman Islands, which we were fully prepared to do, I'd like to say I would have just slept in the next day. You know, there would have been nothing much for us to do. But our $1.3 trillion of derivatives exposure would have suddenly been flipped back to Wall Street. They were counterparties in all that trade. Well, if you have a two-sided position, which they do because they're intermediaries, and one side goes away, all of a sudden you have a one-sided position. So you have to go out and sell that security. So it would have been massive sales of stocks and bonds, more than the market could absorb, and that would have been a panic. So Wall Street didn't bail out long-term capital management. They bailed out themselves by taking over the balance sheet and doing an orderly unwind. So that's what happened then. In 2008, same thing. We were just days away from the sequential collapse of every major bank in the world. So Bear Stearns collapsed in March 2008. Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac, the giant mortgage agencies, collapsed in June of 2008. Lehman Brothers collapsed on September 15, 2008. Morgan Stanley would have been a few days later, then Goldman, then Citi, then B of A, and all those dominoes would have fallen. Again, massive intervention to the tune of tens of trillions of dollars of currency swaps, guarantees, et cetera, to prevent that from getting worse. So two times we came within hours or days away from collapsing the entire global financial system. Didn't happen because of intervention. But look at the intervention. In 1998, Wall Street bailed out a hedge fund. In 2008, the central banks bailed out Wall Street. In 2018, who's going to bail out the central banks? In other words, each crisis gets bigger than the one before. Each bailout gets bigger than the one before. We are now at the point where the next crisis will be so large it will exceed the capacity even of the central banks to do the bailout. And so the resolution, the liquidity injection that you always need, because these panics are always about liquidity. Everybody wants their money back. You know, people say, you know, there's a global dollar shortage going on right now. That's one of the reasons why China's selling treasuries, by the way, not just to get out of dollars, but because they actually need dollars to prop up their own currency because of this global dollar shortage. And people say, well, how can there be a global dollar shortage? The Fed printed $4 trillion. Its balance sheet is over $4 trillion. The answer is that, yeah, the Fed created $4 trillion of printed money, but the world created $100 trillion of debt. There's been no deleveraging since 2008. The biggest banks are bigger. They have a higher percentage of the banking assets of the entire system. Their derivatives books are larger. Leverage is greater. Debt to GDP ratios are higher. Everything that was too big to fail and unstable in 2008 is bigger, more unstable, more prone to failure today. And just to kind of round out that the discussion, when you use complexity theory, which is the branch of science that I use to build these models, and the central banks do not use them. They're using obsolete stochastic general equilibrium models. But when you use complexity theory, one of the things you learn from complexity theory is very sound science, is that the worst thing that can happen in a system, the worst collapse, is an exponential function of scale. Now, that's just a fancy way of saying that the risk goes up faster than the size of the system. So when you double the system, you don't double the risk, you increase it by a factor of 10 or more. So I just explained why we vastly increased the size of the system measured by bank assets, concentration, derivatives, leverage, etc., which means that the risk has gone up even more, which is why I say the next panic will be an extinction level event. It could happen tomorrow. I'm not saying it will happen tomorrow. I'm saying it could happen tomorrow. There's nothing the central banks can do to stop it. You're going to have to lock down the system, which I talk about in my book, The Road to Ruin. I explain exactly how that will play out. And then you're going to have some rescue, whether it's special drawing rights, which is the IMF world money or gold or something else, if you want to unlock the system.
Do the central banks, do they realize that we're coming to a point where this whole thing cannot be sustained? Are they working together to maybe collapse the system?
I don't think they're trying to collapse the system. I think they are aware that a lot of these risks that we're talking about are there, but they don't fully comprehend it. Now, let me explain what I mean by that. The central bankers ran the bailout the last time. They know what they did. They know more than we do. And although a lot of information has come out, but the main point that I make is they've been unable to normalize things since then. For example, prior to the crisis in 2008, the Federal Reserve balance sheet was about $800 billion. In the course of trying to mitigate the crisis, they increased the balance sheet to over $4 trillion, and they cut interest rates to zero and held them there for 7 years. Now, if somehow they had got the balance sheet back to $800 billion or even a trillion and got interest rates up to 2.5%, which is what the Taylor rule says they should be, I'd be the first one to congratulate them. I'd say, nice job, guys. You know, you saved the world and you got back to normal. But that didn't happen. They're still at $4 trillion. Interest rates are, you know, okay, they've crept up to 0.75%, but they're still well below where they would be at the stage of the business cycle. So they have not been able to normalize their balance sheet, and they have not been able to get interest rates back to where they want. So what are they going to do if the crisis hit tomorrow? Take the balance sheet to $8 trillion, $12 trillion? I mean, what's the boundary? Well, legally, there is no boundary. They could, in fact, do that. But my view, that's not sustainable, and they know it. There's an invisible confidence boundary. There's a point at which people are saying, you know, this is crazy. I'm out of here. I no longer have confidence in the dollar, whether it's foreign creditors, U.S. citizens. People just run to the alternatives, and we know what they are. It's gold, silver, land, fine art, natural resources, hard assets of various kinds, or Switzerland, or, you know, take your pick. But they're out of the dollar. And so I think the central bank has an intuition about that, even though they're not using the same models I'm using. And so what they've done to address this instability and this risk is called macroprudential regulation. It's another one of these geeky terms they come up with. But for example, they've increased capital requirements from, you know, roughly 4% up to 8%, sometimes higher. Is that a bad thing? Well, it's not a bad thing, but it's not enough. The thing about bank capital, unless it's 50% or 100%, that's different. But when you're talking about going from 4% to 8%, if you don't need the capital, you can have almost zero. If you do need the capital, no amount is enough. In other words, in a steady state, when everyone's confident and everyone thinks the banks are fine, you actually don't need that much capital. But when there's a panic and everybody wants their money back and you do need the capital, 8% is no better than 4%. It might buy you another couple of weeks before the bank goes to zero. But the point is, it's going to zero very quickly at an accelerating rate. And so that kind of regulation, I'm not saying it's a bad thing. I'm saying it's not really going to work and it's not enough. The other big thing they did at the G20 summit in Brisbane, Australia in November 2014 is they came up with what I call the Brisbane rules, where they explicitly said that going forward, our policy in bailouts is going to be no more bailouts. We're going to have bail-ins. Now, what's the difference between a bailout and a bail-in? Well, bail, and they all have to do with resolving, you know, large, too big to fail bank distress and too big to fail potential failures. How do you deal with that? Well, the bailout model, which we saw in 2008, is you use taxpayer money, you use guarantees, you use money printing, you use government to prop up the bank. No bondholder of any major bank took a penny of loss in 2008, not one. every one of those banks got bailed out. Every one of those bonds got paid off at maturity, or at least there are still good debts on the books of the banks. Not one depositor lost a penny in any of those banks. The tax, the bailout was fully funded by the U.S. taxpayers. Even stockholders lost, the value of the stock went down, but it came back again, you know, since then to some extent. So there was no pain by any stakeholder, meaning stockholders, bondholders, and depositors. All the pain was felt by taxpayers and ordinary citizens in the form of not getting paid for the risk, and also zero interest rate policy, which meant that, you know, trillions of dollars of lost income on savings has been transferred to the banks in the form of zero interest rates, because the banks don't have to pay you interest. So that's the bailout. Brisbane, 2014, they said, for now on, we're going to have bail-ins. The way a bail-in works is that when a bank's in distress, the first loss is going to fall on the equity holders. Equity holders are going to go to zero. You're going to get wiped out. Then bondholders are going to take a haircut. So look at the hole in the balance sheet, and maybe you'll get 50 cents on the dollar or 70 cents on the dollar, but you won't get 100 cents on the dollar. And then finally, depositors will not be protected above the insured amount. So let's say FDIC insurance, $250,000. In Europe, it's about 100,000 euros. That amount will be backstopped, but anything in excess of that, you're at risk. And so the depositors, bondholders, and stockholders will all suffer. Only after all of those resources have been exhausted would any taxpayer money be used. So that's the so-called bail-in. Now, on the face of it, it sounds fair, it sounds reasonable, it sounds equitable. Why not put the losses where they belong, in the hands of the people who benefit and the people who had the upside? And why go to the taxpayers? Sounds good. The problem is, in practice, they haven't lived up to it. And we have concrete examples. In the case of Italy, and pardon my Italian, it's not very good, but the Banco dei Monte e Paschi di Siena, BMP, oldest bank in Italy, definitely a too-big-to-fail bank, that's being bailed out by the Italian government because they don't want to face the political pain of having to put losses on bondholders who happen to be voters, by the way. Well, Angela Merkel was outraged by this, you know, Chancellor of Germany. She turned to the Italian Prime Minister at the time, Renzi, and said, you can't do this. Remember, we agreed no more bailouts. We only have bail-ins. Renzi did it. Well, Renzi's gone now. He lost the election in December, but the new Italian government of technocrats is, in fact, bailing out that bank. But what Renzi did, Renzi turned to Merkel and said, oh, yeah, we can't do bailouts. Well, what are you going to do with Deutsche Bank? And it was, that's a much bigger bank. That they're in distress. They're insolvent. They're going to need a rescue. And are you seriously going to apply the bail-in rules to Deutsche Bank and let German working people suffer losses on their deposits just because they're more than 100,000 euros? So the point is, bail-in sounds fine in theory, but it's not lived up to in practice because of the politics. So there really are no solutions on the table. Bank capital is never enough. Bail-in is not being respected in practice. Meanwhile, the system keeps getting bigger, more unstable. And so when the crash comes, they're going to have to go to what I call, what I talk about in my book, The Road to Ruin, the ICE 9 solution.
What is the ICE 9 solution? What do you mean by that?
The ICE 9 is a phrase I borrowed from Kurt Vonnegut, one of my favorite authors. He wrote a book in the early 1960s called Cat's Cradle, which I highly recommend. It's very funny, dark comedy, but a very funny book, short, easy to read. But in that book, he invented something called ICE 9. There was a scientist who created ICE 9. ICE 9 is a polymorph or a similar molecule to water, to H2O, with two important differences. Number one, the melting temperature is 114 degrees Fahrenheit, which means it's frozen at room temperature. And number two, when a molecule of H2O, water, comes in contact with a molecule of ICE 9, the water turns to ICE 9, which is ice, basically, so at room temperature. So he took this ICE 9, put it in vials, three vials, gave it to his three children. And the plot of the book has to do with whether any of them open it and pour it. If you pour the ICE 9 into a stream, the stream freezes, then the harbor freezes, then the ocean freezes, and all the water on the earth freezes, and life on earth dies. In other words, it's a doomsday machine. And I take that story and bring it over to financial markets as a metaphor, and I make the point that the panic is going to start somewhere. There'll be some catalyst. It doesn't matter what it is. I mean, people ask me all the time, what's going to start the panic? And I say, it doesn't matter. The system is unstable. It's prone to collapse. So whether it's a financial failure, an assassination, a coup d'etat, a natural disaster, you know, it could be a lot of things, but it won't matter. It'll just happen. But it'll show up. It'll emerge in a particular segment of the capital markets. And my number one suspect would be money market funds, because they're supposed to be liquid. They're not really. It's a great misnomer. People think money market funds are money. They're not. But people will call up for the money market funds and say, I want to redeem my shares. You know, wire the money in my bank account and do it now. And what they're going to find is that, you know, well, what's on the other side of the money market funds? Well, there are all kinds of short-term liabilities, and they're not going to be able to roll those over. So they're going to suspend redemptions on the money market funds. By the way, that was not the law in 2008. It was, you could not suspend redemptions. There was no provision for that. Today there is. They changed that law, so you can suspend redemptions. So it's like a hedge fund that puts up gates, and it closes the gates. So then people say, oh, gee, I can't get my money out of my money market fund. Well, I better take the money I do have out of the bank. So they're going to have to close the banks and reprogram the ATMs so you can only get $300 a day for gas and groceries. And people say, oh, gee, money market funds closed, banks closed, I'll sell my stocks. Well, you're going to have to close the stock market. In other words, it's going to go from sector to sector the same way the Einstein molecule spreads exponentially to freeze all the water in the world. And eventually you're going to have to lock down the entire financial system. Now, they'll tell you it's temporary. And like I say, you'll probably be able to get a couple $100 a day for gas and groceries from the ATM while they're working on a solution. The solutions being the ones we mentioned earlier, which are, you know, resetting or rebooting the international monetary system, new rules of the game, SDR, liquidity, maybe a gold standard, maybe a hybrid gold-backed SDR. But whatever it is, these things will take months to work out. And in the meantime, you're going to have this ICE-9 solution. I talk about this in a lot of detail in my book. And by the way, yeah, there are 151 footnotes. Actually, not footnotes. They're endnotes. They're notes, but they come at the end. So you don't have to read them if you don't want to as you're going through the book. But everything I'm describing is documented, backed up, supported either by science, put the equations in the endnotes, or official documents, statements. You can find it all. None of it is fantasized. None of it is, Jules Verne science fiction. It's all happening. It's already happened to some extent. We've seen it in Cyprus. We've seen it in Greece. We saw it in India with demonetization. Europe got rid of the 500 euro note. This is all part of the war on cash. The war on cash is designed ultimately to eliminate cash, to force everyone into all their wealth into digital form. And I like to make the point that, you know, before you slaughter cattle, you have to herd them into a pen. And before you slaughter investors, you have to herd them into a digital pen at one of these, you know, major banks. And once all the wealth is digital, it can be frozen, locked down, confiscated, taxed, monitored, et cetera. But before you do that, you have to eliminate cash. And that's exactly what's going on. So we're already seeing ICE-9 in small ways, and it'll get worse.
How long do you think this will last? When the whole financial system goes dark, how long will people suffer through this?
Well, you know, one day seems like a long time when you can't get your money. But look at historical examples. And by the way, I also make the point, everything I described is backed up by official sources or science. But every one of these things has happened before. So the New York Stock Exchange was closed from July to December 1914. It was a global financial panic at the time. 5 months, the New York Stock Exchange was closed. People actually went out on the street, on New Street, and they traded shares by hand, you know, cash, you know, bring your cash, bring your shares and sign them over. It was called the Curb Exchange. In 1933, President Franklin Roosevelt shut every bank in America by executive order, just said every bank is closed. He didn't say when they would reopen. In fact, they did reopen about 8 days later, but nobody knew when they were going to reopen. That was before the days of ATMs, obviously. You couldn't get your money. In the Great Depression, there was such a shortage of money that people invented wooden money. It was called the wooden nickel. You know, when I was a kid, there was an expression, don't take any wooden nickels. But in the 1930s, small communities would create wooden money, and you would use it for local merchants, and everybody would trade it with each other because it's all the money they had. They made money out of wood. So the point is, all these things have happened before. Now, I would expect that, well, I mean, we have another concrete example. I make the point, none of this is speculation. In 2009, in response to the panic, the IMF did issue special drawing rights in August 2009. Pardon me, people said, where did these special drawing rights come from? And they knew, no, they've been around since 1969. So they've been around for, almost 50 years. And they have been issued from time to time, usually associated with market panics and liquidity crises. The last time they were issued was August 2009. Now, that panic, the acute stage of that panic was September 2008. That's when Lehman Brothers filed for bankruptcy. So it took 11 months to issue the SDRs. Well, even if you put that on an accelerated timeline next time, because the panic will be worse, I don't see how you could do it in less than, I'll guess, but 5 months or 6 months. Certainly a new international monetary order. Bretton Woods, the actual meeting at Bretton Woods just took a few weeks in June 1944, but they had been working on it for 2 years, Britain and the UK in particular, under the direction of Winston Churchill and Franklin Roosevelt, have been working on it for 2 years. So these things can't be done overnight. But even on a crash basis, if it took, and no pun intended, but if it took 3 to 6 months, that's a long time for the system to be shut down. But I think that's a reasonable forecast.
What will the United States look like after this? I mean, you're talking about SDRs. Will the dollar still be in existence? Will we still have our way of life? Will everything go back to normal?
Probably not. I think the dollar will still be in existence, but it'll be a local currency, not the benchmark global reserve currency. I would expect the new benchmark global reserve would be the special drawing right, or maybe gold, or a new gold-backed currency, or a gold-linked SDR. Or else we'll just, the whole system will splinter, and we'll have autarky, and every country will, be on its own with its own currency, and globalization will, kind of grind to a halt. We'll still have dollars, but it'll be a local currency. If I go to Turkey today, I'm going to get some Turkish lira, and if I go to Mexico, I'm going to get some Mexican pesos. Well, if you come to the United States, you'll want some dollars, but it won't be used for the big things, settlement of balance of payments, reserve positions of major countries, payment for oil, things of that type, direct foreign investment. That would all be done, I would expect, either in SDRs or a new gold-backed SDR of some kind. As far as life, it's interesting. I say, if you want to know what's going to happen in four years, read my books. But if you want to know what's going to happen in 30 years, there's an author named Lionel Shriver. She's a novelist, very accomplished, well-known novelist. But, a lot of times fiction writers come closer to the truth than the economists. Everything from Isaac Asimov, 2001 to Jules Verne and others, they've done a pretty good job of predicting the future. But she's a novelist. She has a book called The Mandibles, which I highly recommend. Great novel just on its own, but it's about life in a post-financial collapse world. And the point is, life goes on. I mean, it's not the end of the world. It's not like getting hit by an asteroid, but it's different. So it's not the end of the world, but it's the end of the world as we know it. And people still go to the store, but there's crime is rampant, and if you want police protection, you have to pay for it. And you get to the store, they have certain things, not others. Property is run down, and people are moving in with each other, and people who used to be rich are suddenly poor, and how do they adjust to that? I'll leave it at that. I don't want to give a spoiler alert, but if you want to, and I'm not saying it's going to play out exactly that way. That's not my point. My point is, if you want a very realistic portrayal of what life could be like in a post-financial collapse world, that's the best I've seen. And I highly recommend it.
How can people prepare for this? I mean, some people say gold, some people say silver, some people say Bitcoin. What's your take on this and how to prepare and protect your wealth?
Well, I say gold and silver and a few other assets. But my advice is to put 10% of your investable assets in gold and silver as well. Silver has a very practical application. Look, it's a precious metal. I don't spend as much time thinking about silver as I do about gold. And the reason is that gold is, in my view, money. It's the ultimate form of money. It's not just a monetary asset. It's the only form of money that I think really works in the long run. And so you should definitely have gold. But I recommend 10%. When I say investable assets, I would exclude, you know, your home equity and your business equity. So don't gamble with your home. Don't leverage up your house to go out and buy gold. And a lot of people have some kind of business equity. You're an auto dealer, dry cleaner, pizza parlor operator, lawyer, doctor, dentist, whatever it may be. You've got some business equity. Leave that to one side. So exclude your home equity and your business equity. Whatever's left, those are your investable assets. And I recommend 10% of your investable assets in gold and silver. And the reason 10% is that if I'm wrong, and obviously I don't think I am, but if I am, you're not going to get hurt with a 10% allocation. But if I'm right, that's going to go up so much that it will in effect be your insurance against bad things happening in other parts of your portfolio. And the practical aspect of silver, if you're just trying to preserve wealth in an age of collapse and ultimate hyperinflation, gold will do a better job of that than silver. But it might get to the point, which you do see in the Mandibles and I see, which is where you're going to have to go out and get groceries for your family, you know, and the banks are shut down, the ATMs are shut down. And people say, well, you know, one of the criticisms of gold is, you know, well, what am I supposed to do with an ounce of gold? I want $50 worth of groceries and I got a $1,250 coin to shave off a little bit, you know, or buy a gram or whatever. Well, no, just use silver. So an ounce of silver will get you a day or a couple of days worth of groceries and it'll be, believe me, people will take it in the scenarios we're describing. So I recommend, American Gold Eagles, is a good way to own gold. If you're a billionaire, maybe you want some bars, in a safe place, but and I recommend American Silver Eagles. They're from, you know, there are other good coins around the world, Maple Leafs and others. Some people like these Austrian Philharmonic. By the way, I'm not a gold dealer, so this is how to preserve wealth. This is financial analysis. I'm not selling anyone gold coins, but I do recommend them as a way to preserve wealth. Beyond that, I would have an allocation in cash, and people are surprised to hear me say that. They're like, wait a second, Jim, you're the guy talking about the death of money, the lockdown, ICE 9, why would I want cash? The answer is you might not want it for long or forever, but it's good in the short run. These things can happen quickly, but I don't think it will come totally out of the blue. We'll have some forewarning and some ability to pivot. So for now, cash is, I think people underestimate the value of the embedded optionality. The person with cash can pivot into either maybe more gold and silver or some other asset class as we get nearer to this extinction level event. And land, fine art, these are all things that, will preserve wealth and will do very well. So gold, silver, land, fine art, perhaps natural resources, investments in private equity, venture capital startup companies where you actually know the entrepreneur. You're not relying on a digital payment system to secure your wealth. You actually have a paper contract with somebody you know. And then that can have some value. As far as Bitcoin is concerned, I don't own any Bitcoin. I don't recommend it. Of course, that's enough to get you branded as a Neanderthal by the Bitcoin groupies, as I call them. But I believe that blockchain technology clearly has a future. I mean, remember, Bitcoin is just one cryptocurrency based on blockchain technology. So I think you need to separate the two. I'm not a technophobe. I get it. I read all the technical papers on this. I've actually worked with U.S. Special Operations Command in trying to interdict ISIS use of cryptocurrency. So I know more about it than a lot of Bitcoin people, actually. But so the blockchain technology, I think, is here to stay. But Bitcoin itself, came out in 2009. We have not had an economic downturn since Bitcoin was invented. So we don't know how it performs in the business cycle. I can estimate how, dollars, euros, gold, stocks, bonds, all those assets have been through multiple business cycle. So we have some basis for thinking about how they perform, but we have no basis for understanding how Bitcoin performs in an actual recession or a financial panic, because there hasn't been one since it was invented. So that, to me, that's by itself, that's one reason not to be too Pollyannish about Bitcoin as a store of wealth. I do sympathize, however, with people in repressive regimes trying to get their money out. I mean, that's not easy. And so you see it in China a lot, people using Bitcoin to get their money out of China, and, you know, and elsewhere around the world, maybe Venezuela and some other places. So to the extent you can put your, you know, keep your brain wallet in your brain and get to Bitcoin and get on a plane and come someplace and maybe turn it back into an asset free of the grasp of the failing jurisdiction, I think it does have a place to facilitate capital flight.